Hi there, Courtney here. If you like this type of content, please like and subscribe. I am here for the second part of the questions on, sometimes, let me just say, you don't realize how bad your hair looks till you see yourself on camera. So if you see me flipping with my hair, it's because I'm trying to grow bangs out and I desperately need a haircut. I'm here to talk to you a little bit today about gender equality or inequality and becoming equal, and a report that came out, I was just reading it, that, let's see, it was the new UBS report reveals that joint financial participation is the key to gender equality, and I can totally see that. And as I read this, I was asked to give some opinions, and I'm going to do that. A little bit about me, because I think it's extremely relevant, and that is, I am a 49-year-old female who was married for 20 years with, I had three biological children and adopted late in life, and that is relevant because I was the primary caregiver in the physical sense. I was the one that was taking care of the children, cooking the meals. I also was the one doing the financial responsibility, but I can see how in most households, women would defer to their husbands or spouse. You know, I hate to just say husbands now because the households look a lot different, but one person, because both people should be involved. And that doesn't mean that both people have to do the equal amount of work on the finance, the physical, writing the bills and things like that, but there should definitely be meetings going on. And it talks a little bit about some of the reasons of these issues, that half of women want to be involved more, but they're not, or maybe half are not, and that COVID is making it worse, as men tend to take over the outside chores, women tend to take care of the children and the housework and the cooking and the schooling, especially with COVID-19, and men take over the financial. I'm very lucky, I guess, in that way, that even though I didn't have the best childhood, my grandmother and my stepmother and my aunt were all leaders in finance in the household, and I took from watching them. I definitely had strong female role models when it came to personal finance, and through these questions, it's made me realize how much I did. My mom was also a bookkeeper and single most of my life, so when she was single, she was making, you know, she knew about the ins and outs of money. It didn't always, her actions didn't always follow what she knew, but she knew how to do the math. So she was a bookkeeper her whole life. Even though she wasn't necessarily investing and frugal, she did know how to do that. So, and it talks about, you know, one of the things, and I would say this is a big one that people don't want to talk about, because we don't get married to get divorced. We don't get married to think about something happening to our spouse and then passing away. But the truth is, it happens, right? And we're not always secure about leaving. And that was me. My first relationship, I had a full-time job. I got married right out of high school. I got divorced about a year later. I had a great job. I had a place to go. I was secure about leaving. I knew it wasn't going to work. And then the second time I got married, I was married for 20 years, and I was not secure about leaving the marriage. It was not a healthy marriage. There was a lot of, it was just very bad. It was very bad. And because I had four children, one of which I had adopted, who already came out of a bad situation, when things got worse, I was very afraid to leave because I was not the breadwinner, and I was afraid of what would happen to my children if I wasn't able to take care of them. So anyway, also to keep the peace, we don't bring things up a lot to keep the peace. So the question I was asked is, what would I say to younger women who find themselves not being involved? And I would say to look around you. A wise woman once told me we can learn from all people. Sometimes we learn by what mistakes we see made, and sometimes we learn by what people do that are successful. So I would say to start thinking about your future self by looking at the women around you and the decisions they've made. Maybe ask. I did ask my grandmother, show me how to do a checkbook. This before, you know, everything was online, before the internet. I asked my stepmother, show me how to do a budget. I've asked my parents, what would you do differently? What choices would you make differently? I have been given some bad advice and some good advice. And one of the pieces of bad advice that someone in my family told me was, you'll always have a car payment. And that did not sit well with me. I thought, that doesn't sound right. So what I would say too is trust your gut when something doesn't sound right to you. But you have to start, my advice would be think of your future self, because the likelihood of you getting older is very likely, with a divorce rate of 50%. There's also a likelihood that you may outlive your husband or you may get a divorce. You don't want surprises when that happens, because I want to say the last statistic was 70% of women that get divorced are in 70 to 90% more financially destitute. I can't remember the exact, but you don't want to be that person. And I was. I went from a household of making right under $100,000 to a household of making $27,000 with spousal support and child support. So my financial situation changed drastically, and I was in charge of the finances, but I was enabling and giving, and not saving. So I was kind of screwed, honestly, when that happened. Okay. Another thing is, I was having a conversation yesterday with my parents, and one thing that they told me, and I'm always doing math in my head, was that how much they were living off of now. And I knew, because I knew what they were making before, that that was about 60% less than they were making when they were working. Now, they do have a car payment and a house payment. They're not very big. And fortunately, my grandmother on my dad's side left them some money. But think about that. If tomorrow you were faced with 60% less income, how would you get by? So you need to think about that will probably be your situation. You're in your money-making years. You need to save money in order to get by later. And so having less debt, having no debt, ideally, having savings where you can draw a percentage off of your savings to live on in addition to any pension or Social Security, which we certainly don't want to think that that is guaranteed. So advice would be think of your future self and talk to people who have gone before you and learn from their mistakes and their successes. Maybe, let's see, what would be the first thing you would do to help to change it? I would think about what kind of learner I am. There's a saying, the hardest thing to do is getting started. And we often, one thing that Bill Gates is quoted as saying is, we often underestimate what we can do in 10 years and overestimate what we can do in a year. I think I said that in reverse, but you get the gist. We think, in a year I can do this. In 10 years, you can do a lot. But in 1 year, it may feel it's very slow going. And a lot of people who get into the financial independence world find that. It's slow going. It takes a while, but in 10 years, you can drastically change the trajectory of your life. And I sit here today as someone who's done that. I was making about $15,000 in income when I divorced my husband. And with spousal support and child support, I was getting about $27,000. And I had one other check because I adopted a high-risk child. So I got a board check, which is when you adopt a child out of foster care. I didn't go into it even knowing that would happen, but I did. So $27,000 was my income that first year. I slowly got up to about $57,000 in about 7 years, but it took a while. Now I got debt-free. I increased my income. I got married. My husband wasn't in any better shape than I was when we met, and we've increased our income. We have no debt. We pay cash for everything, and now we're sitting at hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of net worth, the high hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of net worth, and that's just been time, slow rolling, building up. So what you should do first is start. You should start. You learn. Am I an auditory learner? Am I a visual learner? Am I a kinesthetic learner? How do I learn? Do I need to listen? Do I need to read? Do I need to hear it? Do I need to see it? You watch a YouTube video. You watch a documentary. You listen to a podcast like Bigger Pockets or Choose FI. You read a book like First Save 10 or Your Money or Your Life. You find a YouTuber like Frugal Over 50, or PBS has a good one on financial independence, or Dave Ramsey or Chris Hogan, you spend 10 minutes, 20 minutes every week, a few minutes a day, a few minutes once a week, and you get in the habit of educating yourself. Listen to something. Ask the question. Mr. Google, you ask Mr. Google a question, you'll get all kinds of answers. Go to Reddit forums, whatever you like. But start learning. And that is the biggest thing, is get started and make a habit of learning. And as you learn something, you make a better change. And then you build and you build and you build. So that is my advice for younger women and men too, if you're watching. Get started, think of your future self, talk to people who've come before you, learn from their wins and their mistakes. In my next video, I'm going to be talking about what yoga has to say about finances.